So on the jab, we're extending like this to the target. Cross, we're extending like this to the target. This is brought back and down. We don't leave it up, and we don't pull it away from our head. All of our rear hand defenses have to be in play. Right now we're doing it in a technical aspect, but later this all becomes a movement and a dynamic that has to have these foundational elements in play. This is where you develop that. As this comes out and I rotate into my target, this comes down. I still have a curvature. I don't want to pull forward with my pelvis, and I want to have that come forward because it will throw my base off. I will have to have a wider base to compensate for such a thing. So we sink down so our head is still over our base. When I extend back to here, same position. Versus here where I have my pelvis forward, my stomach forward, which means I'm going to feel that I can't extend as far. So out here, I'm good. We're looking for this comfortable zone where you are stable and dynamic at the same time. And you're unique. Your physiology is different than anybody else's. So you have to get into yourself. You have to discover where all these are. So relax. When we add movements to this, during our step and slide footwork, we will step and slide, add a jab at the end of it. Step and slide back, jab on the end of that. Step and slide forward, jab. Okay. There's another one we do, which is a jab on step, which is done all the time in our fighting. And it's also done with our weapons. It is a movement that goes forward on the step, we jab. So it's not that we step and then jab, it is on the step we jab. On the step we jab. You have to have the foot down before you can actually start firing the jab. And what I mean by that is I cannot fire this while I'm in transit and expect the hit to be as powerful as I can deliver. If you have this punch out in the air because it's unsupported, any impact from your attacker or your opponent is going to transfer immediately to your base. And if your base is only on one foot and you're in transition, you will be unstable. Jab on step is that movement like that. And then your movement into it. Jab on step becomes a cross on step. Like that. The more I can rotate my hip over, the better. And again, all of this movement back and forth after a strike is to help stabilize. You can rarely throw out strikes and be in perfect balance after the strike, especially after you've hit a dynamic opponent. So that's where you just adjust. And it's perfectly okay to do that. So one of the main things that you're going to do to learn these strikes is to hang a piece of paper. It's one of the best training methods for you being able to transfer power through a target. You hang a piece of paper and your goal is to relax and strike through that paper. Sometimes you tear the paper, sometimes you tear yourself because you're too tight and you pull a muscle. You have to relax into it. Nice and light. That's the jab and your cross. Hang the paper, do the work. If you don't have paper and you just have somebody who's holding out their hand, that works just as well. Remember, or a little warning is that if the person's doing it well and they're transferring really through you, they won't be able to hold their hand up for very long because you will penetrate through and it's very jarring. It'll be a painful experience because you have a small surface area making contact and powering through. On the hit, it is a relaxed hit. When I extend outward, I let the fingers fling off. There is no tightening of this at all. This is why this is really important to get this down first, because then you understand what relaxation is through your hits, so that later, when you do tighten on impact, you have the relaxed musculature through a strike already ingrained. So that's how we do this. So you want to make sure that your movement through it is relaxed all the way to the fingertips. Let that fling out. One of the biggest keys for this particular one, and then we're going to do more, so there's more videos coming, is just, like I said, do the paper strikes on the target. The other thing is to get used to your movement. Back and forth, relax into it, side to side. You can switch out leads if you want. Work both sides. We demand for our training that you are equally capable on one side as the other. Always remember that if you are working your base, that if you step forward, you also don't step in line, so that all of a sudden you are now more unstable. You want to make sure that you are here in the same position as you were when you started. If you are starting with your feet underneath your hips and you take that comfortable step forward, there is a specific placement where your feet are right now. What people tend to do is, as they step forward, is they bring this foot up in line like that. So you want to make sure that this doesn't occur. Because what happens is we tend to move people into that range and we actually strike them on the imbalance points. So we'll get them to step so that they are in line. So you want to make sure that if you are stepping forward and you happen to go like this, and that one comes in line, go from that point on, just reestablish. And so this is why it's important to train with another person who's able to observe that. Well, that's why a good instructor is a very positive thing. But if you don't have that, videotape yourself and or get in front of a mirror and do this, because you need that feedback. What we have in our head isn't always played out in reality. So when you see it back on film, you look at that and say, oh yeah, I need to do this or do that, I'll correct this. It has a big effect, because when we train, and I train my students, whether it's in private or group training, we generally will film them at certain points in the training so that they, at vital points, so that they can then see what they're doing, and we play it back. Because me just saying it is one thing, but when they can actually see themselves doing it, they make a better connection to it sometimes. So have that as a valuable thing. Set up the camera, review yourself, and allow that as a feedback mechanism to help get yourself in a better position, to a better mechanics. Again, that movement, beyond striking the paper, just do your movement, footwork, back and forth, relax into it, switch out, get back into cover, speed up, push, shuffle, slide and step, whichever one you're going to be working. This is all part of your movement in your shadow boxing, because later you can stop out at this and you can shadow box. So one thing I will tell you not to do right off the bat is do a traveling cross, which means I will not sit there, and because I want to throw this punch and I want to move, I go like this. This is a very unstable strike. If you are interrupted or hit, or you actually make contact, your base is compromised. So do your movement, change your range, switch your side, then fire. Don't go off into a position where I'm going to go from here and try to throw this. Traveling crosses are not stable strikes. Do not develop that bad habit. Otherwise, move around, get used to that. Relaxed, get back into position to where you are working your cover nice and loosely. Remember, part of shadow boxing, part of extending all this out, is that you are also struck back. You have to deal with the hits. You have to deal with threats coming in, and you have to adjust accordingly. You don't sit there and you are just always the attacker. That's unrealistic. And if you train unrealistically, you're going to have a tough time when it comes to a real fight. Next time, we'll cover more of the cover, and we'll add a couple of the strikes on pads.
Slipper. Yeah. I was actually proud of myself for not falling.